Good afternoon, Scott Rella, T3 Live. Welcome to today's recap. Here we are, another day up, another day extending, another day of different setups working themselves out, another day of some people frustrated, some top caller, some this, some that. You name it, there's everyone out there all trying to say something. Okay, at this point, it's really you just got to kind of let your P&L do your talking. And if you're not feeling it and you're a little uncomfortable, don't do anything, you know, to in a stubborn fashion, because you know you're behind the eight ball, you think you're not doing or making what you feel you should be making. So with that said, you know, the S&P went to another new high today. A lot of people on Friday when we had the jobs numbers said, okay, this is going to be your exhaustion gap on finally some good news after an extended run. And what happened? Didn't. It was an exhaustion gap. We gapped up, came in this week, said, can we hold above that gap and then extend higher? And if we do, you know, there'll be lots of setups along the way. You look at the chart here of the S&P, and you know, you could see, you know, first actually I'll do the SPY so you could see that gap, you know, that gap up. Here is a trend that's been intact since November. Remember this nice red dog reversal when we were giving our little seminar in Vegas for Charles Schwab, you know, and then it's just tested it once right here, okay, when it also held the 50-day. And you know, look at this move that we've had. All right, there's been many different pivot points. Real quickly, I talked about it on Twitter. Some guys wanted me to go over it. You know, spots where you had to make some decisions, whether you were a bull, a bear, or a trader. First decision spot of 2013 right here, when we took out the 1474 high. That was if you, you know, were bearish and you did not or ignored this gap up, which wound up igniting the move, and that was because of the fizzle cliff, whatever. You know, that was your spot to say, okay, I'm going to get, you know, I'm going to cover here right now. You know, we're getting through 1474. This is your spot to say, okay, we're going higher. And if you were flat or you approached a year, you know, with a little risk off in this gap up, as we digested the gains of this gap, that was your spot to get in there. Then lo and behold, you know, here we go. That was your move to 1530, the minor correction that wound up holding, you know, and then this was your, you know, little area where if we, you know, if you got out of some stuff here, or you reduced your positions, you said, look at this wide range bar, maybe it's going to lead to a bigger correction, and it didn't. So this was your spot to get back involved in some risk, put on some positions that are working out, look to see where the money was rotating. You know, so P.S., another move up to the high here, okay? This was another spot where after hitting this high, once it broke back below, you could have got a little flexible, taken a little risk off, right? That was right here. And then what happened? Held the 50-day, held support, held this gap from back here, and then we resumed. If you, you know, were thinking that perhaps we were gonna have this head and shoulders top pattern, which I did throw out there saying it had the potential, you had to switch gears right here, right when the market took back this area. Okay, once we took back 1565, 1575 and negated this wide range bar to show it had no power, no influence, no meaning, that was your spot to get back in some positions. Doesn't have to be like, you know, all in. You didn't have to be back in 20 positions or whatever. You could have been back four or five. And then here is where we wound up holding higher in front of the jobs report. And even if you did not take equity or you don't like to have risk in front of a non, you know, farm payroll, you know, there was actually action thereafter where you could have got involved. Or when you saw this gap hold earlier this week, you could have said, okay, now I want to get involved. I see a lot of money out there rotating around, and here we are 4 days later, once, you know, 63.39 in the SPX. Here we are at 16.32. You know, I did the same type of chart work here, but I went over it with the spiders. And you know, at this particular point, it's definitely difficult if you think about where we came from, you know, to sink your teeth in. But if you look at the rotation and you look at just chart patterns and you look at these add-on type trades that we talked about where you have a big move, you consolidate and go again. On those trades, you put some on, you don't have to be again tier three. You could use a day and a half tactic or a few day tactic like we talked about this week with the banks and then move on. So, you know, let's look at some action real quickly. First, let's go over Bank of America. You know, we've been talking about this all year. This is when you had your ad, when it crossed above this 1241 and then above 1254, and now here we are, 1302. Looking really good. We've been talking about this bad boy since, you know, $8. This was your last core trade, and here you go again, stair-stepping higher. Yesterday, I put on JP Morgan. You know, everyone saw it go positive on my VTF. Right when it took out this area, right when it took out this 4870-ish, okay? Nice little gain yesterday, and then we talked about adding potentially through this resistance, okay? And then right around 40, I would say 4990-ish, you know, I took a little bit off, but I'm still holding some. I still think this looks good, acting well, but it's had three up days, so it might need to rest. Wells Fargo also had a nice clean breakout above this area. You know, I bought it yesterday, held it overnight, sold some today, you know, just because I don't need to have 100 banks on. I have two that I'm committed to. Citigroup also, you know, had a really nice trade, but I left this one because, again, you don't have to be in everything, but this nice trade, wide range bar, you know, been best in breed banks. So this week, you know, without having to call the top, you could have been invested in the banks. Or if you don't do that and you got, you know, you sized down, you could have tactically entered the banks and you could have tactically sold them and made money and not worried about, you know, the macroeconomic scheme, that what the Fed's doing. If 2 years from now, like Verbini says, is when the crash is going to happen. Yeah, let's live in the day. Let's live in the now. We need to make money. Okay, you have a lot of different time frames. You have macro, intermediate, you have swing, you have active, you have MoMo, you have all these different things. Just know where you are. As far as, you know, just some quick tech, Apple still hanging around. It goes ex-dividend for tomorrow. I don't have it overnight, but it does look really good. Okay, this was your entry around 420. Went up, took back the 50-day, going sideways. I'm hoping it opens down a little bit tomorrow and then absorb the ex-dividend. And then I think through 465-ish, you could be a buyer. And then, you know, you have 469. And then I would say that, you know, everyone likes my 80% probability scheme. I would say I put my 80% probability or higher that we, you know, get 500 plus and test a 200 day, which would be a nice tactical swing. Okay, my swing is actually off now, but I would go again to see if we could do that. Okay, you have a gap here. There'll be a lot of different tactical plays along the way. If you're long Apple, I think you're in good shape. You know, Google, ever since the earnings, when it triggered back above 803.5, look at that move. Okay, I know guys in the Sol conference were talking about it, so it helped, you know, re-energize it today. You know, this stock could have built your wealth over the course of the past decade. All right, this was my high beta play of the year last year, you know, and because of this nice tight pattern here, and there you go. So you could be a trader trading it, or a macro investor, a stock picker building wealth. Anyway, really nice move. Looks pretty good. It's continuing along. You know, some guys are talking about eBay today. You know, at this point, it's a little bit of a weaker type of scenario ever since earnings, but here it's trying to get into the gap. I still think this is okay. Perhaps it fills the gap up to 56. Amazon's also been weaker, but it too has, you know, a choppy mid-level setup that for cash flow, doesn't mean it's got to get to new highs, doesn't mean it's got to explode. For cash flow, if it gets above this 258.60, you know, maybe you see $3-4 as a trader tomorrow. Who knows? As far as LinkedIn, it bounced after the earnings and then kind of got rejected by this wide range bar and by this gap, which is going to control this for a little while. See if it stays here a little bit longer. If it winds up taking out this 173.72, perhaps you do see 165. I've been telling guys just let this be either actively traded or, and if you know, or it's just put it in the penalty box. Let it stay there. It could see this easily, maybe even get a cute short. If you took it into the earnings after a huge move like you saw, you knew that you had risk there. And if you're, you know, long this from the pattern that we talked about, you know, over the course of the past few years, you know, with this channel and the cup and handle, and you're in it from here, then you just have to deal with some of the volatility, and I think you will be fine over time. Facebook gave a small red dog reversal today. Still, you know, still acts pretty poor. You know, after earnings, it had a decent move through this 28. It should not have given that back, and it did. You know, I haven't really touched it since then. So today, you know, into the 50-day, into this small tactic, I bought a little bit just to see. So at this point, we'll see what happens here if it builds. Red dog reversal is when you try and find a counter trend trade with a plan. You know, traded below this day's low, close below it. Traded below this day's low, close below it. This time, it traded below 26.85, went as low as 26.65, traded back above it. That's your buy price somewhere around there. Your stop is today's low, and then maybe, you know, you create some cash flow there. We'll see. As far as, you know, some other types of trades, we had a few bottom feeder type trades with China having a bit of a rebound. There's been some trades in different sectors. Some people have been riding this FCX, had a nice move off the lows. X, nice move off the lows. Today, I think a lot of people in our virtual trade floor made some nice money in CLF, okay? Nice lower level pattern. I talked about it, I think, the other day. And then today when it triggered, I went after it. Here was your gap up, went sideways. Then here was your level. It went above it, closed pretty well. You look at, you know, the basic studies, you go to volume, see what kind of volume, decent volume. So no reason why this thing can't try and work its way back to maybe 25 or even higher. This stock back in the day was a heck of a lot higher. So, you know, a laggard trade is not, you know, is not always the best things to go after, but why not? You know, people are looking for things to do, and this one could be one of those. It's pretty heavily shorted, so we'll see if that continues. And then talk about other laggard type plays. You know, the Chinese stocks themselves have been pretty weak. Baidu has, you know, woke up yesterday and then had some follow through today. You look at the daily chart here and you'll see it got, you know, first of all, it's gotten really beat up from up in this 160 area. And then you go to this big support here and, you know, finally, if you're an active trader and, you know, it's not a 52-week high trade, but, you know, here is where it woke up, right? Here's where it woke up and traded above this little area. And then here is some follow through. So we'll see if this can make its way up to the gap. You know, at this point, some of the meat out of this bottom type trade is out of the way, but it could continue. Sohu, no one's talking about, and this thing's been an animal. Okay, I'm sorry that I haven't put it on any of my stuff, but, you know, this thing's been coming off the lows and, you know, broke out and, you know, at 2013 highs, looks pretty good. Sina, which I am long, does look like, you know, it could get a little frisky again. Here is your gap up. Okay, this was, I think, the Alibaba news right there, and wasn't enough juice to get it closed on the highs, but now after about 6-7 sessions, it's consolidating really well. If this were to start getting above 58.35, perhaps it tests this area or continues higher. I think there's a lot of shorts trapped in here, so we'll see what happens. It's, you know, something to do. As far as gold, a lot of frustrated people out there in gold, but, you know, on an intermediate basis, it does look like it's going to try and make another move here. Okay, 42.48. Here's your intermediate trend line. Every time it's tried to do it, it's, you know, it's been very hard to deal with. But if it does get above 143, perhaps you do see a move to test the 148, which is the 50-day. And if you look, you know, that's also a retest of that broken macro support that you saw right here. Macro-wise, it's still pretty broken in my opinion, but at this particular point, if you're not a gold bug and a macro trader and you're looking for action, if we do see some kind of move above this 143, you know, I'll probably look for a little bit of a scalp long also. We shall see. Right now, it held support, and who knows, maybe it could go a little bit more. As far as some of the retailers we talked about, you know, kind of choppy today, a little disappointing. You know, at this point, this is part of the risk of trying to play add-on type trades or 52-week high trades. You know, if it doesn't happen, you know, it could either mean it needs more time or you get some kind of corrective activity. I think it was upgraded and went down, so, you know, that got me out of it for now. If it were to get above this high in the coming week or so, maybe I'll get back involved, but for right now, I'm kind of out of the way. Same thing for Walmart. You know, just hovering up here, I'm not investing in this now. I feel like the time to have been in it was times that we talked about, you know, way back when in Walmart 2 years ago was our, you know, retail stock of the year, had a really nice move when it broke above this. Okay. And then even at some point this year, we talked about it getting back on its game above 72 and then right here. So up here, I'm just looking for some type of continuation trade. So until it starts looking like it, I'm going to be out of the way. Under Armour did have a decent move, still looks good. You know, closed near the highs, holding the moving averages, didn't extend yet, keep that on the radar. TJ Maxx gave another day, you know, nice breakouts, continuing. Trim and Trail, that guy. Raw Stores, kind of like the other ones, not sort of ready to get going, but still hung in there. So if it does clear above this, you know, 66.50, perhaps tomorrow you get a move. So all in all, there's a lot going on in a lot of different sectors. Oh, finally the ags. You know, we had Jill in here 2 weeks ago who said, now's the time to focus on the ags. It's probably a second, third quarter play. You know, look at what Mosaic did today. Mosaic was also my 2013 thesis for ags. And finally, you know, it rewarded and sustained the move. Okay, so this is where it came into the year, right around here. So here it is on its way. You know, 65 is next, and then maybe into the 70s. So this is nice. I guess we have to see what happens with CF after the close, but overall, nice trade. If you took it because earnings are after hours, you know, you made some cash flow. It woke up yesterday when it cleared this flag, and guys in the VTF were talking about it. Unfortunately, I didn't buy it. I can't buy everything. And then there you go. Monsanto, still in my opinion, is best in breed, looking like it could extend up here near highs. I guess we'll see what happens with the CF. CF closed near the highs, right into resistance. Guys might be trading it after hours. We'll see what happens here. But this also looks like a little bit of like an inverted head and shoulders pattern, where here's your neckline, which is supposed to give you a move maybe through the 200 day. You know, this typically, you know, usually was a stronger ag, but there is action there. So I'm going to wrap it up. The bottom line is, you know, you don't need to be, what's the word? I don't even know what I'm trying to say, because on Twitter I have a lot of followers, and everyone's like, I can't believe you're still trading this rally, or, you know, you're being a little rude to the shorts, or you know, I can't wait till you get bagged. I don't know where these people come from. All I'm trying to do is throw out quality setups that continue to move. I try and give them a little bit beforehand, and sometimes I give setups that I'm not even in, you know, but at this point, you know, there is setups and active movement that you don't have to be looking for macro moves. If you're in a macro trading account, you probably don't care anyway, and you're kidding yourself. That means you've been probably putting S&P monthly flows in, like my wife, into a nice 401k for the past 7 years, and you've made really nice money. You have a good cost average, and you know, you're making money in a money management type of way, which at this point you probably don't care about for another 10 years, and I think that's the way to go, even if you're doing it for a kid. You know, but if you're approaching the market on an intermediate time basis and you're trying to, you know, create alpha, obviously right around here is a little tricky. You know, if you're trying to just be a day trader because you don't have the overnight risk, there's a lot to do also both ways. So there's a lot to do on every time frame. You just have to be pretty honest with yourself on which one you can handle, and not kid yourself if you're trying to do too much, or, you know, you're trying to revenge things that you missed. So with that said, you know, we are extended here. At some point, we might see some kind of pullback. You go back to the S&P. At this point, still, you know, it's just trending higher. You know, at some point, maybe we get some kind of topping tail or some type of red dog reversal where it pushes through. 1632 squeezes everyone, comes back down, creates that tail, and then we correct a little bit to the 8-day. But, you know, if that's all you're looking for, you're missing a lot of action along the way. And, you know, at this particular point, I would just take it as it comes. If you're not comfortable, do a little less. If you don't want to be in 10, 15, 20 positions, be in 3 or 4. And just continue to read the market, watch the price action, and stop looking at what everyone's saying out there, because everyone, you know, is saying different things for different reasons, and you never know what their true intentions are, you know. But with that said, hopefully they're good. And at this point, what's today? Wednesday, I'll be hosting CNBC Asia tonight from 6:10 to 7:10. If you get CNBC World Markets, tune in. If not, I'll see you at the morning call with Brittany. Go Knicks. Have a great night.
I'm Evan Lazarus, Chief Knowledge Officer for T3Live.com. You don't become a great trader by watching videos and taking courses. You become a great trader through live screen time. Accelerate that learning curve by tapping into the experience of seasoned professionals. Currently, we're offering 5-day free trials to each of our 4 mentoring rooms. In the mentoring rooms, we teach our strategies in the context of the live market. To sign up for a free trial, go to the T3 Live education page, fill out the form, and get started when the next trading session begins. We hope to see you in one of our mentoring rooms.